Dellen Millard was a, you know, well-spoken, very articulate. He was wealthy. And he was intelligent. He'd be like the last person you would think would be a serial killer.
The pictures taken with the cell phones, text messaging, as well as internet browsing, are all combined into one chronology of events. It reads very much like a movie script.
You know, not just the media, the people in general, you know, realize that's all it was a truck. Why didn't you just steal the truck? It wasn't just to steal a truck. I told the one Crown attorney, I will not retire until the Bosma case is finished. And I think my line to him was, when he goes away, I go away. The Bosma case was close to home. A day after he went missing, I was golfing with my neighbor, and when I came out, there was a flyer on the car. And it was the picture that everybody saw in the media of the truck and the phone number. That took place in Hamilton Police Service jurisdiction. They started their investigation as a missing person that turned into a homicide investigation. I became involved as part of a multi-jurisdictional case manager. Back in the early 90s, Paul Bernardo and Carla Moca were convicted of some very brutal murders. Toronto Police Service and Niagara Police Service were the two main agencies involved in that case. And after a review of the case, there may have been an issue with communication, so I ended up at the multi-jurisdictional major case management, and that is to assist coordination between different police services. The main linkage that basically crossed us into the multi-jurisdictional point was a glove that was found that contained the DNA of Dellen Millard, his girlfriend, and Tim Bosma. That exhibit was seized by IDENT, was sent to the Center of Forensic Science. They ran the DNA through to type it. Dellen Millard's DNA came back associated to another piece of evidence that had an unknown donor on it, and that was a handgun that was used to kill Wayne Millard. So now we have the two cases linked, and you have two police services involved now.
I became involved in the Dellen Millard case in May 2013 when Hamilton Police Service put a request into the OPP Tech Crime Unit for assistance with the seizure of what were believed to be computer-related exhibits at the Millard Air hangar in the Waterloo area. We sent five people the following day, and they assisted in taking down two servers. Servers were seized, as well as additional computers such as laptops and workstations.
There was over 30 terabytes, 60 plus exhibits. At the time, it was probably one of the largest electronic seizures for homicides. And that took a great deal of time and work. And Jim Faulkner from our technical crimes unit here did an amazing job.
The 67 exhibits included roughly 13 cell phones, 15 workstations, 9 laptops, GPS devices, and removable media.
Basically all the stuff you had to make an exact copy of, and then you would store that original somewhere for court.
The step after that was taking the data and processing the data in a manner that we could begin the analysis. On Dellen Millard's seized computers, we located a dozen or more iPhone backups. Pictures and videos are very important and can contain metadata which offers an additional level of information than just the picture itself. Metadata is data within data, and typically what we find is GPS coordinates,
main piece of evidence that I would say that came up was a photograph of a blue tarp rolled up in a cylindrical fashion. We pulled off the metadata on that photo, which came back to, I believe it was July 3rd. Laura disappeared that weekend, and the metadata showed an address on Roseville Road, which is where Dellen Millard's farm was.
We were looking at an investigation not only of the death of Tim Bosma, but an investigation into the disappearance of Laura Babcock.
We also seized evidence from her phone that showed a period of time that it was being used up until it basically went dark. Millard's phone is basically in parallel with her phone up until that point. They're in the same location or appear to be in the same location. The tarp itself, like I say, it looks like, judging by the size of the dog and the size of the tarp, it looks like there's could be a body rolled up in there. Again, we go back to Hamilton's case with Tim Bosma. There was a device that Millard had on his farm. It was an incinerator. And inside that incinerator, there were some bone fragments. There were also some grommets that appear to come off of a blue tarp that you would buy at any local store.
Another interesting finding was a picture of a handgun. The picture of the handgun was taken in such a close fashion that the fingerprints, or the fingers of the individual holding the handgun, were visible. And the picture was sent to a fingerprint specialist who was successful in identifying the hand as belonging to Dellen Millard based on the fingerprints in the photograph. So we were able to link him holding a handgun associated to one of the murders.
With all the electronic information that we've got, all the cell phones, all the tracking we did, the locations, you have to put that all together in one big piece and show that to a jury. And the grounds did a great job. And like I say, it's like reading like a movie script that Jim always would say, you basically have to follow your evidence and you've got to put it chronological. And some innocuous piece of information might not be that credible until you put all the rest of that stuff with it. You throw in the video of the truck going by in Bosma case. We matched that with the cell phone because every cell tower gives off a signal. And as you get outside the one radius of one cell tower, you pick up the other cell tower, and you can basically track a person's movements from point A to point B.
At that point, my task was to take all the most relevant findings and include them in an electronic report. Electronic reports are critical to the court process, because they not only include the findings, but they include such things as the chain of evidence to show when the evidence was received and to ensure that we can prove it was received in a proper manner.
I gladly sat through court to make sure that our evidence was presented the way it was supposed to be presented. It was, you know, by far by the Crown's did a great job. Sitting beside him, He did not acknowledge me. Like sometimes he would say hi or he would nod. And like I say, I just would walk right by him. I just, like, he wasn't there. Like I have no use for him whatsoever.
A family member of the victim comes up and engages you in conversation and may thank you or discuss their feelings about it with you. And really that's the most rewarding thing. You're working for the victim and for the families of victims, and that's very rewarding thing to be able to do.
Borutski set out to kill these three women. That was his intent, and I think it's different from other serial killers in the fact that it was all done probably within the period of 8 hours.
I received a phone call requesting me for an active shooter.
Essentially, the manhunt started.
I caught sight of something white. Didn't initially know what it was, but circled back around to get a better look, and the object was gone.